done that, you know, they're typically pretty flat.
Hey, well, there's Baldy back at Baldy. There's John Paisel back fishing in up the blank. And you know what's funny for me is to watch everybody's technique. It's a little bit different. They're all trying to do the same thing, but they all go about it in a little bit different system. And right now, this is looking painful for me. Yeah.
I always wonder, so when I get out of the shower, I have a sequence of how I towel off. I know it never varies.
Inside,
is it the same for you or for these guys? Do you think they always start
right
by
there.
Touching one rail over another?
White
or,
on black?
You know, is there a system that's different?
I think I certainly have one. My approach is I never try to touch the same tool twice so that I'm not redoing stuff. So I'll go through the motions and stuff. So, I mean, like, I wouldn't be doing this, what he's doing, but it obviously works. Look at the killer boards he makes for John John. So it's a finished product.
So you mean going back from the shear form up, doing the stringer, back to the sanding the rails?
Yeah, it's kind of different because he's trying to replicate something as well. So it's probably not his day-to-day routine where he picks up the plane, he knows got two cuts off this rail and a pass off the bottom or something, but he's got to go a little bit slower, and he's got a little mapped out. You can see he's got a couple lines there at the back of the tail, and so he's trying to make sure that everything comes out to specs because the guys aren't going to judge you on your technique.
No.
They're gonna measure things and take a look and see if you came close to the original MR.
Do you know John Paisel?
I just met him today.
I was wondering if he has shaped these types of boards in his history of shaping, or if this is a kind of a one-off, a first deal.
I really wouldn't know. I mean, he's famous for making the boards for John John Florence, and I thought he would be a bit younger. I don't know how old he is, but he's closer to my age than I thought, so he's probably got a lot more boards under his belt than we might.
Have you shaped a board like that? Have
oh,
you
yeah.
shaped many of those twin fins?
Oh, that was my,
I
that's
know.
My deal,
come
dude.
On. I Let mean, it out.
In the early days, I started making twin fins for David Barr, and what I did that was a little different is a little bit like what MR did is we took the Brewer shape, because I was working for Brewer at that time, and put two fins on the bottom, so he had the flat deck and full thick rails. And their traditional twin fins were coming from Spider Murphy, South Africa, that Sean Thompson's was riding. And they were all foiled out for riding New Pier and the ways around Durban. So my boards were more for sitting up on top of the water and going rail to rail, where theirs was just digging in and holding in the barrel. So
right.
And I think MR blended the two pretty well.
And what's interesting in watching the guys shape, and we got to interview Pat Rawson and Wayne Rich at the same time, and they were talking about that fluted wing into the concave and what that did to how well it made the board ride.
Well, the wings in the earlier days were actually that lead, start the turn fin of a thruster, you know, because you release off the back fin, but we had nothing on the rail to hold and give it a little bit of direction. So thinning that wing out really affected how the performance went, especially when we went to a twin fin. It almost reacted something like today's four fin.
Wow.
Give you a little bit of bite.
It was neat interviewing Taz, because he said after he was finished, you know, what was really hard was getting those flutes right and the concave, but directly where those wings in, the tail's completely flat. So it was hard to get that curve and not have it continue into where it's supposed to be flat. And he goes, I think MR, when he did it originally, maybe left that unshaped till the flutes were done, and then just came back in and...
Well, it'd be interesting to see how I actually did it. Like I said, it's not how you do it, it's what you get done.
It's who wins.
That's it.
Now, have you been a winner of the Icons of Foam?
No, I only shaped one time, and... Didn't win. Yeah.
Well, it's sure a great job by all these guys, and it's fun for the fans.
Yeah.
I mean, even the shapers are fans. They're all watching each other,
oh, yeah.
standing around watching Reno, and I'm sure now they're all watching John.
well, if you're shaping, I know a number of people came up to me and said, wow, those techniques you have, it's so, so smooth, and how you did that, I really learned a lot. And so there's a lot to be learned from the 16-year-old kid, too.
Yeah.
How does he approach it? What's he do? And the older guy that's done a million of them. So.
Yeah, that absolutely. I mean, he's just started surf shaping since, well, 4 years, 12 to now.
Yeah.
Pretty amazing. And it's great here. Oh. We'll wrap it up. Yeah, I was going to say it's great here with the Q&A shaping booth, too, on this side. I watch Matt Biolis sit there and engage in August, Robert August, you know, with fans asking him whatever they wanted. It's a great thing at this Surfboard show.
Yeah, I'm really enjoying this one. I mean, it's really evolved into something that's relaxed. You know, trade shows used to be just such a grind. You know, I hated it. But now I'm down here and enjoying it, and relaxed, getting to talk with my buddy Baldy, and,
yeah,
you know, and much better.
And we got Daniel Thompson in the Q&A, but we've got to get to a commercial break, so we'll be back with you soon live from this Boardroom Surfboard Show here at the Del Mar Fairgrounds.
The closest thing to surfing outside of the ocean yet. We'll be right back.
We're back, Gary, here at the Boardroom International Surfboard Show at Del Mar Fairgrounds. We're watching Daniel Thompson, Tomo, shape up one of his amazing futuristic otherworld surfboards. I love looking at his stuff.
I was over at Firewire and Chewy Reyna was over there and I go, Chewy, is that something you paddle with? And he goes, yeah, these things are incredibly fast.
Yeah.
So, try it.
Yeah, and I was talking with Daniel earlier, and everyone he says is working on wider and thicker, and he's working on narrower and straighter. So his concept is counterintuitive.
Bunch of ways to skin a cat. Right?
Yeah, but he sure surfs them well.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Yeah, it's fun to. I can't even imagine the questions people are trying to ask him because I can't get my head around his concepts, even when we interview him on the Bassey and Baldy show on the radio.
He surfs so incredibly. It's like one of those things that could be a door and he could make it work. And
He's cheating.
Yeah, well, I don't know.
Look at the scene out there. Lots of people here down at Del Mar Fairgrounds. And here we are. I'm Jeff Baldwin. This is Gary Linden. And we have a guest, Dann Mann, from Air Corps Blanks, right?
Incide Blanks, yep.
Incide Blanks.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and so the gist of our whole thing is to have a carbon structure on the inside, like a miniature snowboard, inside the blank that anyone can buy and shape, any shaper could use and produce their design around. Instead of a wood stringer, it'd be a carbon structure on the inside of the board.
And going with that, you've obviously ridden lots of them and making the prototypes. Do you find the flex patterns quite a bit different than balsa stringers or carbon rails? I mean,
yeah. So the what I've always wanted to do since I've ridden my first carbon board, the first carbon board I ever did, I glassed it with a real light EPS core, and I glassed carbon around that. And ever since that board, I've been wanting to produce that sensation of carbon driving the not only the load up of the board, but the spring back and the way the board comes back quickly is what I'm trying to harness and to control and have it be a soft or a medium or a stiff flex. And by doing it on the inside of the board, you can create a situation where you're not glassing carbon fiber. You can standardize and keep consistent the difficulties of a glass job and keeping them neutral and not adding another variable like you would if you were to glass carbon fiber in mass production. It'd be very difficult. So by having the carbon on the interior, you're accomplishing carbon driving the way the board bends and comes back, and you're taking away the hassles of working with it on the outside. On top of that, you have the structure of the board not slaved to the external shape of the board. So if you glassed a big, thick board with carbon fiber, it'd be stiff as a board. If you glassed a thin one, it'd be too bendy. So you can control that factor through the part on the inside that's in the middle of the blank there.
I just don't know how you actually blow the carbon inside the blank. I know that it's EPS blank,
it's EPS,
right?
So it's a series of cuts and vacuum bag process that gets
okay.
It. Yeah.
So you don't actually blow the foam
no.
around it. Okay.
No.
So yeah, what I was wondering is, you've obviously done all this R&D to get the correct shape profile. Mm-hmm. It looks like it's about 1/4 of the size of the real board,
yes.
or something like that.
Yeah.
But you must have gone through different shapes to come to that final template.
Yeah. So if you were to cut it in half and look at the cross section, it's scalloped shape so that the top part is curved. It's about an inch thick, and they vary. We've been switching around, but it's settling in to be about 12 inches wide, and the carbon goes across that arc. And that arc is key, and that was a big part of the research development phase of getting that curve to dictate what the carbon's actually going to do. If you laid that carbon flat, it'd be like a sheet of metal. It'd be blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
And then as soon as you corrugate that sheet of metal, it becomes corrugated wall. And the same thing, same effect happens with the carbon. By making it a compound structure, a compound curve, it creates a lot more structure in it. You don't want too much because you want the board to bend. And everyone's changing design and changing shape, like we were just talking about with Tomo. But there's a profound effect to the sensation of surfing caused by the flex of the board. And we all know that. Anyone who's surfed a lot and surfed a board into the ground and had to hang it up because it's dead, it feels like a wet noodle, that's the board bending but not coming back anymore. That's a whole bunch of micro factors that have happened in the polyurethane foam or the expanded polystyrene foam and the glass, and it's just failed. And the load of the bend is put into those structures that have broken or been broken down. And that's why the board stops having that pop, that liveliness. And so by having the carbon inside, you have the longevity of that flex pattern put into the hands of carbon fiber, which is a really high performance and long-lasting structure material.
The thing I like about it is you've got the weight and the strength in the center. The problem I've always had with the EPS boards is the weight's on the shell. So it doesn't give it forward direction,
right.
and that is really a problem. So this is really interesting for me because it's right in the middle, so it acts like a stringer, right. Gives it some direction, and then like you said, there's not so much chance of a loss of memory because it's flexing inside and it's not exposed to the elements.
Right.
Because that exactly. Sunshine so, and man. Cold is Heat, it's yep. expand and contract, expand and contract, every turn, every cutback. And there's a certain limited number.
Yeah, finite.
Yeah.
Well, and then the other thing about that is the EPS in and of itself is not a structure as much as polyurethane is. No. So guys say, yeah, EPSs are floaty or they're corky. And I would say, yeah, it's because it's not supported. It's not structured like a PU is in and of itself. So by carrying carrying that out closer to the rail, you have support and structure out towards the rail that EPS doesn't necessarily have in and of itself. And more trying to mimic what a polyurethane with a wood stringer, I mean, everyone's had a magic PU with a wood stringer. They're insane. It's a great thing. But there's always somewhere you can go to improve that with consistency, and value for the end users, and repeatability. And that's what I think you can best achieve with carbon fiber.
So are you distributing with lots of the board brand manufacturers
so far? Yeah, so I just partnered up with Futures Fins, and we're offering it to any surfboard manufacturers, and we're going to start just brand new starting.
So it's just brand new. I just know Matt Viola seems to gravitate to working with everybody. He's just a lot of guys are intrigued by something new and want to give it a shot.
That's the idea, is to get other shapers, not like, you know, it's been a small group that has been buying it from me. I've been using it on my own little brand, and I think the most exciting thing will be, like what you say, is that when other shapers with totally different concepts and different concerns come in and address what we're trying to do, it'll just get better, you know.
Each blank is custom made then, right? So your tolerance will be consistent? You're going to an inch or something?
Yeah, they're customizable. There's going to be a set rocker schedule for anything under 6'9 right now. And you know, if you needed to tune it, you know, more quarter inch in the tail or whatever, less in the nose, we can adjust for that. But there's 7 blanks right now. 6'4 and under, there's 5, and then there's a 6'8 and a 6'9, different rockers. And widths, because it's EPS and it's cut, it's widths aren't a problem, and thicknesses can be kind of whatever too. So,
Were you going to show us some stuff? You had the blank over there.
Sure.
I wasn't sure.
No, I mean, they just wanted to have a little, a little eye candy for
you. You weren't going to give it the flex?
Yeah, you can just see that. You can show the compression. So what I'm trying to get is the way the board comes back up at the.
All right, cool. I didn't know how far my.
The load is one thing, and how much the board bends down, and if you see how it comes back up, that's the main thing I'm trying to control. This is a medium, a little on the firm side.
You know, when I was working at Walker Foam, I used to go up and sell blanks to everybody, and Al Merrick was one I learned most from. And he put the blank up, shaped blank like this, and he put it up against the wall and push it in and watch it spring back. And he goes, well, this blank's good, this stringer is the one I want. And I was sitting back there, this has got really nice memory. And yeah, interesting.
Well, and again, you know, by orienting the carbon, by changing the shape of the internal structure, you can make the compression and the spring back kind of infinite. You know, you can make it whatever you want. So if he did do that and said, no, I want it to be quicker, you can easily orient, change the pattern of the carbon on the inside to get that effect.
And so you were saying you call this the brain, the inside of it. Do those come in different densities? Like, let's say you're making something for Hawaii or
You'd have a different layer on the top and the bottom.
Right.
So for the medium, we have 4 ounces of dry carbon fiber that you can orient in different ways to get the to get the bend that you want. And if you wanted it to be more bendy, you could reduce that amount of carbon, or you could change the way the part is shaped to get it to be like a corrugated wall, sheet metal. It has those radical curves in it. If you neutralize those, it would become more you know, bendable, and you can do the same effect with the curve of the deck.
So there's a lot to come, it sounds like.
Yeah, there's a lot of different combinations.
Hand layup or vacuum bag?
Vacuum bag.
So you're using it on table, and that's why you got the stock rocker.
Right.
But you can
manipulate all that stuff,
All right, well, Dann Mann. Is there a website? You said it's just starting
out. Rideinside.com or Google my name or Incide, I-N-C-I-D-E.
Great.
Yeah.
I'm sure it's going to be successful.
Fresh out of the mold? Because it looks like a high saturation of resin.
It came straight out of the mold, but it's been around a while. It's been beat up and everything. So.
But you've got a lot of resin for vacuum bagging.
It was with a plastic sheet over it. So we didn't have a breather or anything. We just left it.
Okay. Yeah. Good job.
Yeah, thanks.
Thanks.
Yeah, yeah. No worries.
Exciting.
Thanks, guys. Yep.
Cheers.
Good luck with the show.
All right. Really interesting, Gary.
Yeah.
I have a feeling you might be working with those.
Well, you never know.
Well, here we are at the Boardroom Surfboard Show, and we're going to go to a commercial break here shortly. And when you come back, we'll be with you again, or it might be Todd Kline and Dave Stanfield with Matt Biolas.